In this lecture, we're going to continue with talking more about wireless networks, and we start out with satellite connections. Satellite connections have been around for a really, really long time, but for most of that time, they have been really slow, they have had high latency, and they're very expensive. Just like any other internet connection, you would have a modem, you would then connect that to a satellite dish on your roof or wherever, and that satellite dish would be 1 or 2 feet wide. That's 60 to 80 centimeters. And the ones up till recently would have a latency about 500 milliseconds. That is half a second. Many of them higher. And then the speeds would be somewhere maybe 10, 20, 30 megabits per second. And then on top of that, they can easily be hundreds or thousands of dollars a month. And I know this because when we moved to Puerto Rico, I wanted some alternative internet connections that were not reliant on the power grid. Because the power grid here is not very good. Even if I have a stable fiber connection or DSL connection, even a mobile hotspot, when the power is out, obviously in my house I can have redundancy, I can have batteries, I can have a generator, I can have solar. But what about the internet provider? What if the power is out in the entire area? We just had a hurricane where the entire island of Puerto Rico was without power for more than 10 days. My internet still worked because I had satellite, but the radio wave connection I had doesn't work, the cable connection I have doesn't work, the cell phone network doesn't work. But I was able to have internet the entire time because I had Starlink. And that is the newest player on the satellite internet market, whereas before the satellite connections would have somewhere between half or a full second delay on internet traffic. With Starlink it's maybe 50 milliseconds, that's a 20th of a second. And my internet speeds are about 150 megabits download and 50 megabit upload. Way better than I can get even on a cable connection here. So now that I'm done declaring my love for my new satellite connection, let's move on to cell networks. And cell phone networks really just are regular networks all the way up to the antenna. It has fiber, it has copper, whatever it uses to connect back to the service provider. From the antenna and to you, it's wireless. And it's called cell networks because you can see over here on the right, you can have those little cells. And when they're up against each other like that, they provide full coverage. And in most cases, they're not going to touch exactly like that. There's going to be more coverage. This is more of a visual to show you why they're called cell networks and how the coverage works. This is exactly the same we wanted when we designed our Wi-Fi networks. We want that overlap between the access points to make sure that the user gets that completely seamless experience they never know when they switch from one network to the next. And then just like our Wi-Fi networks, each cell is sending on a different frequency to compare to the ones that are just around it. So right now we really have three different types of cell networks that we use, 3, 4, and 5G. For the exam, I don't think you need to know those numbers. I don't think you need to know the speeds. Maybe just know that 3G has a much bigger coverage area and it's much lower speeds. 5G has a tiny coverage area, but very high speeds. All right, let's recap. We start out talking about Bluetooth. Bluetooth uses the 2.4 GHz band. We use it for PANs, personal area networks. And even though Class 1 Bluetooth can reach up to 100 meters or 300 feet, most of the ones we use them for something that we can reach out and touch. Bluetooth is somewhat security through obscurity. First off, because it's not a very interesting target. Secondly, you need to be very close to the device to actually try to hack it. We talked about BlueJacking, that is sending unsolicited messages over Bluetooth. BlueSnarfing, that is where they access information of the Bluetooth device. And BlueBugging, they gain control over your device. But BlueBugging is only feasible on older cell phones that have not been updated. Any newer cell phone that gets automatically updated is not susceptible. And really here, all the countermeasures are common sense. Turn off Bluetooth when you don't use it, pair your device, then stop pairing, and don't accept pairing requests if you didn't send it. Then we talked about Li-Fi that uses light to transmit data. We talked about Zigbee. Here, it was a mesh wireless network with low power, but also very low data rates. Then we talked about satellite. It used to be really slow, really expensive, very high latency, but with Starlink, you can actually get very fast speeds, low latency, and a reasonable price. And for my use case, when the entire power grid is out in all of Puerto Rico, I can still have an internet connection because it's not reliant on any of the infrastructure here. And then finally, we talked about cell networks, how it's a regular backbone internet connection all the way up to the tower. From the cell phone tower to your device, it's wireless. It's called a cell network because it's made up of little cells. They should, just like our Wi-Fi, overlap so the end user never notices when they go from one antenna to the next. And then we talked a little bit about 3, 4, and 5G bands. I don't think you need to know the speeds. Just understand that 3G and 4G has huge coverage areas. 5G does not, but it also has way higher speeds. And with that, we are done with this lecture. I hope this has helped you get a little bit of a better understanding of different types of wireless networks that are not Wi-Fi, but still some of them we use on a day-to-day basis, and others that have a very specific use case that you may or may not ever see. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next lecture.